things to get through tonight. We're going to start off with a recognition. Adam, if you could do the introduction.
We'd like to recognize Eli Pugh. Eli was recognized by the Indiana Association of School Principals and the Indianapolis Star as an Indiana Academic All-Star. To get that recognition, each high school in the state can submit one student towards the contest, and then they select the top 40 seniors in the state of Indiana to be a part of that recognized group. So it's a very prestigious honor for Eli. We're very proud of him.
Friday evening was our senior awards night, and Adam and his staff did a wonderful job with that, and Eli had the opportunity to represent himself well that evening too. But just a special thank you to Adam and his staff, and also to our community. It was about a two-hour program, and when you have that many speakers rotating in every 3 or 4 minutes, and each scholarship was a minimum of, I think, $250. That is a lot of community dollars going back into our city. So we are blessed in that respect, and just want to thank everybody for valuing education and valuing our seniors and the job and the work that they're doing and they're furthering their education. In the same respect, Eli started his morning very early this morning at about 6:45 at the Optimist Club, and I want to thank the Optimist Club not only for their scholarship, but for their wonderful speaker this morning. Former Olympian Greg Bell was there this morning. He had an amazing message to our youth, and I'll tell you, I walked away with some information as well, and it was just a really blessed morning. So thank you to those at the Optimist Club for having that, not only the scholarship for our seniors, but the opportunity to have a motivational speaker come in and to share his story with our youth.
Congratulations, Eli.
Thank you.
Good job. Okay, so we'll move to the consent items. We have the minutes of the April 18th regular board meeting. And minutes of the May 4th study session. Are there any additions or corrections? Now we need a motion to approve.
So moved.
I'll second.
Okay. Any discussion? All in favor? Okay. And on financial report, Val?
So in your packet is the financial report. I'm going to start off with the rainy day tonight. Normally we don't report on the rainy day. It doesn't get tax dollars in, not a lot of activity nearly occurs on it. But for the month of April, we did receive $48,872.81 through Senate Enrolled Act 67. But pretty much in a nutshell says it's a one-time distribution of local option income tax that we're able to get pursuant to the Senate Enrolled Act 67. So it's through state funds, state legislators, and then it had come down through Fulton County. So leaked our current balance in the rainy day up to $119,417.78 in the rainy day. So that's something new on that. General fund started with $576,146.96, had $986,501.50 worth of receipts, $1,306,412.78 worth of expenditures. We did that three payrolls. We did go through for April 2 months. In 2016, we'll have three payrolls. The next one upcoming is in September, so we're preparing for that as well. So it's not so much of it. Leaving us a cash balance of $256,235.68. Any questions with general fund before I move on to debt service?
Is the anticipation then that with return to two payrolls in May that will
exactly?
Let's see.
Debt service didn't really have. I'm sorry.
So isn't there a couple times a year when tax monies go into the general fund? Is that
general fund has tax monies that go into it
Every month. We receive our, it's called our basic grant, which is support for how many kids that we have enrolled in the district. So we get those monies every month of the year. It's the other funds that we only get them in June and December. So debt service, capital projects, bus replacement and transportation.
So, yeah, so besides the payroll, was there anything else that was unexpected that has us at this level?
Not really. Towards the end of the school year, I'm finding that that's when a lot of the supplies for the upcoming school year are purchased. Teachers get ready to leave in the summer, want to have everything ready for when they come back in the fall. So that was another, I want to say, kind of abnormality of normal expenditures as well, but not too terribly a lot.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
You may note, Mallory, too, that we had a bill to Duke that was paid out of general fund this month.
Right.
Which was quite large.
It was.
So there's a cap in how much of the utilities can be paid out of capital projects?
It's 3.5% of 2005 basic grant that we received. So, and fortunately, because 2005 was a long time ago, the school finance department of the Department of Education, that they provide that to us on an ongoing basis to remind us. So that's kind of an item to be mindful of as we move forward to assess where the best need is. Capital projects has a lot of things going on, and so does general fund. So it's, you know, continually assessing which fund can afford it the best, depending on what it has going on in expenditures and the needs that to fit the district.
Any other questions for Beth? Okay, thank you.
Moving on to debt service, it started with $1,373,140.59. Only we get a little bit of property tax replacement credit on an ongoing monthly basis. That was in the amount of $8,663.45, leaving an ending balance of $1,381,804.04. Capital projects fund started with $565,360.14. Had about $5,630.07 in receipts. Month-to-date expenses were $90,692.47. And leaving an ending balance of $480,297.74. Not a lot going on this one. Just a few repairs as necessary and things like that. And in addition to our technology staff is paying us as well. Transportation started with $808,908.66. Receipts were $2,083.48. Expenses were $54,273.54, with an ending balance of $756,718.60. Again, ongoing maintenance and repairs to buses and things as needed as well. Plus our bus drivers are paid out of this fund. And last but not least is the bus replacement fund. $231,979.76 is what it started out with. It had property tax well at $536.73. No expenses because we only buy buses probably about once or twice a year, and the need has not come up yet. It's still being addressed and identified to fit the district for the upcoming school year. So the ending cash balance is $232,516.49. Is there any other questions in regards to the financial statement?
So at this time, we're not looking at any buses for the coming year yet?
Not yet. It's still an ongoing conversation. I have a meeting scheduled with Michael to address those needs. And tax levies for those comes into June as well. So looking at how much we'll get versus how much we have, and then filling those needs from there.
Good. Any other questions? Okay, thank you, Val. Need a motion to approve the financial report.
So moved.
Okay, motion by Jenny.
I second that.
Second by Steve. Any other discussion? All in favor? Motion carries, 6-0. Okay. Student stakeholder focus donations. Several here. Olson Auction FFA overpayment from a customer for an item sold in auction, $9. Jeff and Wendy Zent prom photo booth, $200. Rochester Athletic Boosters RHS athletic wrestling warm-up uniforms, $2,608.38. Hope Shalley RHS choir, $50. Carmen Reeves RHS athletics, $100. Fulton County Literacy Coalition Riddle Tug of War Rope. United Methodist Service Guild, Columbia, school supplies of pencils, glue, crayons, etc. Team Pride Athletics, prom photo booth, $200. Rochester Greenhouse, second graders flowers, flower pots and dirt. Rochester Boat Company, photo booth, $200. Mayor Ted Denton Riddle, the tree book. Fulton County Farm Bureau, FFA breakfast, $150. And from Fulton County Farm Bureau, $150. An anonymous cash donation to the FFA breakfast, $33. And we have Dairy Queen, free Sunday coupons for all students with perfect attendance. Rochester City Pool, 5-day pass for PBIS winner. B&K, $10 in root beer tokens for PBIS winners. RMS faculty, iPod mini for PBIS winner. South Bend Cubs, 4 tickets for PBIS winner. And these donations are received for the basketball shooting gun. Rochester Basketball Club, $1,700. Northern Indiana Community Foundation, $250. Joe McCarter, $250. Are there any others? Okay, we'll need a motion to approve the donations.
I move to approve the donations.
Okay, motion by Steve.
I'll second.
And second by Lisa. Any other discussion or questions? All in favor? Motion carries 6-0.
Just a big, huge thank you to all those very generous people in our community. It's amazing what we can do as a school corporation because of all the support we have.
That is. And you think about all the little needs that different groups need that this fills in for, and it really helps a lot. Really appreciate it. Okay. You have the overnight field trips.
We have two overnight field trips that are being proposed at the high school, and I believe that Adam is prepared to speak on both of those. The first would be the Costa Rica trip that you're working on.
The Costa Rica trip is for students in the Spanish club. It's very similar to the trip that has been taken every 2 years for the last several years. This year, Mrs. Zubman is in charge of putting that together. The whole trip is run through a travel agency, so they're in charge of putting together the entire trip, much like the Washington, D.C. trip that the main school just took. You guys have any additional questions about that?
Adam, does it take a certain number of students to sign up?
I believe it is either 15 or 20 students that must go in order for the trip to occur.
I think I read it. I think I read that it said six actually to make it feasible. Yeah, it says at least 6 students will have to go in order to make the trip feasible. In years past, do you know of any problems that probably precede you? But
they went the year before I started, and they said that everything went great. So, and they're using the same company that they used at that time.
Okay, Jason, do you recall anything when you were there last week?
Issues brought to my attention.
that Mrs. Zartman will be taking the lead as opposed to, probably for the first time.
Correct.
But she's been on it before.
Correct.
Maybe the elephant in the room, but the Zika virus issue, we're watching that.
I did speak to Mrs. Zartman about that, and she said with the elevations that they're in Costa Rica, that the mosquitoes are not as prevalent as in other parts of Latin America, so she said that where they were going, for the most part, they didn't feel like it was a problem there.
Anybody have any questions, Brown, about the Costa Rica trip?
I just have a comment that, or a suggestion, I guess, would be that any student who may decide to go, it would be wise for them to be made aware of travel insurance policies. That's wise, regardless. Mm-hmm. But this company especially, which, while we've had good experiences with them, using them for middle school and using them in the past year, their cancellation policies are quite abysmal, quite frankly. But students can take out private travel insurance for very little amount of money, and that will help guard their investment should they choose to go. So I would, and that, you know, that can happen for any reason why they're not able to go.
That's a good point.
We'll go ahead and vote on this trip. The motion approved.
I motion that we approve the Costa Rica Grand Tour trip.
Second.
Okay, motion by Lisa and second by Brad. End discussion? All in favor? Motion carries 6-0.
The second field trip is an annual field trip that the FFA takes every year to the state FFA convention. And Justin Pearson has organized multiple overnight field trips and always has had a good experience for the students and there. And so I would recommend that we move forward on the approval for the state FFA convention. Adam, I don't know if you have anything specific to add.
Is a location on that, West Lafayette?
Is it Purdue?
This is a trip they've been taking for a long time.
Yes.
Good experience for them. I move that we approve the FFA trip.
Okay, we have a motion by Lisa.
I'll second.
And second by Jenny. Any discussion? All in favor? Okay, motion carries 6-0. Okay, moving on. Information analysis. Policies.
Gang policy. This is by law. We need to have this gang policy revised and approved, ready to go by next month. It was read for its first reading at last month's meeting. Since then, Mrs. Vance has met with the advisory committee that was suggested through the law, which included local prosecutor, judge, police officers, probation, sheriff, and using their suggestions as well as our input, we have a reading then of policy 5840. This is a replacement policy for criminal gangs and criminal gang activity. We will have this updated online soon, but I won't read it all for you. Are there any questions from the board? We did discuss a little bit of the study session.
We'll consider this second, third reading.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
I read your mind on.
There was a lot of good input there. I don't recall everybody for certain. I know Chris Saylors was there. Christy Bixler was there. Thank you. They were not. That was the activities. Skeeter was there. Oscar, were you a part of that? I'm not sure who else. There were quite a few of us there at that table and had some really good conversations around that. Prosecutor. Yeah, Mr. Mars. just very good conversation on how the community again could rally together to support us in this policy and what would be best, not only for Rochester schools, but for all of those entities as well, as they really are the ones in those situations that would have to safeguard the school and the community. So a great, great meeting.
Okay, so I'll need a motion to approve the game policy.
I move that we approve the gang policy.
Okay, motion by Steve.
Second.
Second by Don. Any other discussion? All in favor? Okay, motion carried, 6-0. And we're moving on to math textbook adoption.
If we could, we'll begin with Rochester Middle School. Oscar, if you want to share, I know that you presented a lot of information, and I believe that Lori is here as well to take us through that process and final decisions.
Yeah. You okay if we combine, since we're getting the same textbook?
Sure. I mean, that's okay with me if it's okay with board members.
Is the board okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
We're going to let the ladies
there.
So for middle school, we have two. We have, we're lucky. We get the book in both forms. I've sent around. On each table, I put an example of what the textbook will look like this year. I guess I'm used to facing this one. I need to face this one, don't I? Each child will get a volume one and a volume two for each semester, and it's an actual write-in textbook. They can actually take notes along the side. All of our vocabulary is in here. ISTA practice. There's one of the big selling points was after each chapter, there's a 21st century where I have used this last month with my kids and they have really enjoyed it. They can go online, look up how much education it takes to do that career and what other things they might need. There'll be online videos at the start of each chapter, which I'll introduce, like how this really relates to the real world. And I don't know, Scott, if you'd want to.
I can go through.
Pick on one, maybe.
So, I feel very comfortable going through the algebra one. I'm not sure about Lori, so I'll just click through mine real fast.
Sure.
As for the teacher edition, this is what mine will look like, and then I can go and have access to the ebook. This is what, hopefully, we don't have flash on here.
Good job, Kissel.
Lori, that's a good thing to bring up because right now with our iPads also, we can't get Flash, a lot of the games and everything, the geo boards all relate to Flash, but McGraw-Hill is, they're working on converting everything over to where they things don't need Flash. Well, so we're hoping to be good to go then by August. That's their goal,
If this had Flash, the ebook would come up and it would just look like the textbook, so the students will have that for their MacBooks. So for my class, I will have a class set of books for the classroom, or if a student like knows that they don't have Wi-Fi or they have a Wi-Fi issue, they can check out a book for me. Otherwise, I will not have textbooks. They will have the ebook for their on their MacBook. But as a teacher, I have my lesson plans here. I can keep everything through McGraw-Hill. They offer that as an option through my menu. Everything is here on the side. My resources are here. My plan and present is here. Let's say I want to go and plan and present a lesson. And the best thing that I like about this is right now, everything that's paper pencil, I have five different books on my desk right now. And everything is great, all my resources are there, but technology-wise, everything is located in one place. So if I'm on chapter 6, lesson 6-1, I want to plan on graphing systems. Everything is right here. My focus, my teach, I want to teach this lesson. Here's my questions. My worksheets are over here. One of the things that I liked best about McGraw-Hill, I'm going to be selfish, I do flipped classroom, and my personal tutor videos are already built into McGraw-Hill. So I don't have to utilize another website. I don't have to ask Adam to get me iTutoring. and use a different resource, it's already built in. So the kids can click right here on the personal tutor and watch the video that goes along with this lesson.
So that was super easy for us to find too. You can just type in the subject and it comes up with all your choices of all your videos that
right.
you can choose.
Then for practice, this was really great for us because it's already differentiated the homework. So I teach two different algebras. I teach the accommodated class that is already broke down for me, and then I have the Gen Ed Algebra 1 class. So I have that already broke down in terms of what problems that I can assign those students. And so then if I have some students that are accelerated, that's also broke down for me. So we really liked that option.
And on my end, it was for our RTIs, and it was broken down into the kids that were above and on and then below. And what we found that we really liked, for the below level, it was all hands-on, like activities to do with them that we can do during our RTI periods to make it so they can catch on a little bit better. So it was totally different activities.
We like the watchouts. They point out what type of errors happen in each lesson, which is something that we commonly find. However, they're making sure that we point that out to each student. So that's under the practice. The assess, it gives us tickets out the door. I know that that's something that we always try to do, is give them a quick assess. Plus, there's plenty of opportunity for us to build our own through McCrell. They have a almost their own type of exam view where you can generate your own exams. Differentiated instruction. Again, lots of opportunity for you to break it down even further than just in the practice area. And then Sketchpad resources. For the high school level, one of the things that we were really excited about when we were going through the special features and the resources with McGraw-Hill is they made sure to point out that almost in every lesson there was an explore and extend lab. And for us, really focusing next year on PRBL and problem-based learning, is we wanted to make sure that we were tying in lots of projects with our students. And so McGraw-Hill tied in a lot of those extend labs. And so in most of the lessons, this is where you would find that towards the end of the chapters. So I felt like at the high school level, we were really looking for real life connections, those extend labs. We were looking for resources to tie in for differentiated instruction. We also have two classes that connect with Alex, and McGraw-Hill has that connection with through Alex as a resource to tie that into your curriculum. So I know through Mr. Card's class and Mr. Kelly's class, they will be able to use the curriculum here and then use Alex as a resource to support their curriculum. So I felt like this McGraw-Hill, it was the best connection for all of our teaching styles, because I'm a big flipped instructor. They use Alex as a resource in their classrooms, and good old Mr. Screeton's old school, but he still is. He sat down with me on Friday and went through this, and he was like, oh, I can do some of this stuff. So it was very encouraging.
And it's for us, it's more of an organizational thing with our kids, and that's what's so nice about this. It's all right in here. Their note taking, the lesson, the examples for parents. With our past program, that's kind of been a big issue. There weren't a lot of examples for parents. This will have the examples right in it. We also will have it online. Kids can actually get it online, and I passed out the little, this is what's kind of nice when you go online. Lori's was at the top. It's the same type of deal that it tells you what each thing is, the videos and all of that. We also have a hands-on activity for each one, a project at the end. It follows our standards grade. That was the very first thing we did, was brought up our state standards. Made sure that it went in order, and it follows our sequence, our pacing guide really well.
Lots of vocabulary.
Tons of vocabulary.
Could not believe how many vocabulary activities that this book enriches for Algebra 1. It was amazing.
And like if I have that favorite worksheet from back 1982 that I still want to use, which I still have a hard copy of, I could actually download that and put it right into my section. So it would all be available right there.
How does this connect for ECHO and for Canvas?
So everything that we have on here is going to be able to be downloaded as a PDF, all the worksheets, all the quizzes, all the tests, and then we can save it onto ECHO. And I tried it, everything works. I was very happy about that because that was one of the things that I was worried about, especially without having an actual textbook or an actual, like I'm really nervous about letting go of my workbooks this year and Adam's not ordering me any. So I was kind of worried about that, but I was able to download the worksheet on the trial and upload it onto ECHO and I had no problems with that. So for me, I know it's gonna be a huge transition without copying papers. Like I'm not gonna have to do that. It's gonna be saved, download as a PDF and upload it onto ECHO. And then, I mean, my kids don't write on a worksheet anyhow. There's not enough space for them to show all their work. So it's really gonna be a lot easier for me in terms of time and not losing papers, and it's going to be right there on the ECHO page for them, and so it should be a lot more simple.
And ours is the same thing. We'll be able to upload it there onto Canvas just like we do now.
Will your lesson plans, because you showed how you could do your lesson plans, will those transfer right over?
They could, but I think that I will still do everything on ECHO because that's where the parents can see that. I mean, I don't know that I'm going to make that transition yet. I might try a little bit with it, but if the kids and the parents are still already used to checking ECHO and everything's right there, I don't want them to have to go check another place too. So I'll probably still stick with ECHO for everything that way. But I might try a few lesson plans in here just to, you know, play with that, because they offered so many things for us to be able to just stay organized in here. I was just amazed at the organization that they offered through their lesson planning.
And they'll come back a few more times for more training if you want it. And
do you feel like their sales support and their tech support has been?
It's been great.
There's there was one thing in algebra. They have a comic book on integers, and it starts in algebra 1.
Sounds hilarious.
I can hear less, but I'm sure it's gonna be fine. But it starts in algebra 1, and then there's the second volume for algebra 2. And she was all excited about telling us this, and I was sharing this with Clint. So I told her, I said, okay, so does it end like to where I could make a project out of it? Like, could my kids create a comic strip, you know, because I was telling her how we do these problem-based learning things in my room. And so she emailed the lady who created the comic strip right away, and she says, okay, I want you to make this into a problem-based project for this lady at Rochester right now. And so she's already emailed me back this week and said that she's working on creating it into a project for me. So, I mean, I felt that was really cool.
Can you ask a really good question, Jenny? Because in the same respect as the high school and the middle school are ready to move forward with board approval, Riddle is on hold right now because the company that they elected to go with, we are really struggling with their rep, with the payment process, with return phone calls, with information. So that is such an integral part of this. So that's why you see Riddle on hold right now. And I commend the Riddle teachers for being able
McGraw Hill's coming tomorrow night.
To rally together and to look at that, not only for consistency, but also just for the sheer frustration, if that's what you get at the very beginning of the process.
When they're trying to sell you.
Exactly. Right. So that's why Riddle is currently on hold, because we're exploring, and you've asked a very valid question. If they don't come out of the gate ready to support us after they have our money, they're going to disappear. So.
Like she sent us right away that day the correlations between Common Core and the Indiana standards, so we'll have all that ready to roll. And
yeah, they've been wonderful. Mm-hmm. Like I said, she sent me a project thing right away, and so we've been very happy.
And kudos to you guys for quote unquote working across the aisle. So it's a you know how many children go to the high school for algebra? I know Dylan was one of them, and Moria. And so I'm glad to see you reach across the aisle. So kudos to you all. So it all interaction works together.
Thank you.
And then pre-al is just so you don't have to think it's all the same. Pre-al is more of a traditional textbook, but it will also come with a write-in workbook. Right? And it follows our seventh grade standards really well. There was, I think, only one that I'd have to supplement with her in. So. Any questions?
The fee page that we have here, why are you banging it?
That's your turn.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, you're fine.
No, you're fine, yeah. He's the money man.
Shall I wait for his part of it?
No, this.
No, that's.
Each student gets one of these, right?
Yes.
And they can ride it.
Yes, they'll take it home every year.
Every year?
Well, they'll get a new one every year, like that's theirs, yeah.
So, is this like a durable cost or is this? Is this included in the price sheet?
Yes, that, the way that I sent you, that is included. For 6 years, we get a new workbook for the new set of students every year.
And is this part of their fees?
Yes.
Okay.
And to be honest, what we are adopting, it'll actually be a dollar cheaper on our textbook rental than what our kids paid last year from middle school.
And they get this?
Yeah.
Dollar cheap?
Yeah. Okay. We charged 14 last year, and with the price that we got quoted, it'll be 13 next year.
And am I not mistaken, but isn't Valley going with this? And
yes, Valley.
Yeah, which makes it kind of nice, you know, we do have, I think there's a couple other areas, schools that were going with McGraw-Hill, because we do have these kids that kind of come in and out with the three or four local school corporations, so that would make it really nice that we're kind of all on the same page there, too.
Any other questions?
If there's anything we can do to help the elementary, like if Riddle does, I mean, we have a really good relationship with the rep from McGraw-Hill. We'd be more than happy to come over and help. But her name's Laura.
So were these the workbooks that were available at the high school? Is that,
we don't
talk about workbooks at the high school? Were they like these?
The workbooks at the high school, I didn't feel comfortable going with anything hard backed because they didn't really support everything that we were going to use online necessarily. I wouldn't use them all the time. So I didn't want to waste a book like that if I wasn't going to use that all the time.
Were they more traditional maybe?
Yeah.
Back to the.
Thank you.
You did well.
The old school that I like.
Thank you, ladies, for a good presentation.
That was a great presentation.
We need to get our assignment.
That's our bio.
The dog ate it.
Okay, at this time, we need a motion to approve the math book adoption for the middle and high school.
I motion we approve the math book for the middle and high school.
Okay, so motion by Brad.
I'll second.
Second by Lisa.
Go ahead, Jenny.
Okay, end of discussion. All in favor? Okay, motion carried 6-0. Okay, moving on, economics textbook adoption.
And Adam, if you would like to share, I know last year we had a curriculum which was donated, and this year that is not the case. So if you would like to share how you went about the process.
We adopted all the rest of our social studies curriculum last year, and we did not adopt an economic textbook because we got a donated book. This year we were then charged for, and we were told the price of what we were charged this year was going to go up next year, and they weren't sure how much longer they could keep making it. So we made the decision to adopt the economic textbook that went with the same social studies curriculum we adopted in every other subject area last year. And it'll be the same way. It'll be, we'll have an online version, and we'll have a classroom set available that students can check out if they don't have access to internet.
Need any other questions on that?
I would assume that then it's been a successful transition with that company for the social studies, the other social.
And all the other subject areas, it's gone very well.
Good. The motion to approve the economics text.
So moved.
Okay, motion by Jenny.
I second that.
And second by Steve. Any other discussion? All in favor? Motion carried 6-0. Moving on, approval of the school handbooks.
At Rochester Middle School, you should have a hard copy in front of you that they graciously went through and outlined the different changes for you to follow through. And Oscar, if you'd like to walk us through that, and if I'm not mistaken, Candy probably did that, all the back behind the scenes work of that.
You are exactly right.
Candy is forgets to do the presentation, keep in mind Candy was doing the technical work back behind the scenes.
So if we have questions, we'll ask Candy.
Yeah, when I blank stare at you, she'll jump in and say. I guess several of them are just basic word changes. You know, I know we got like page two, we changed the word book to document just because that's the way things have changed kind of with technology. And then some of the other things, like page four and five, those changes had to do with, at one point in time, I know, I think when Jana was at the middle school as the principal, they wanted to align the handbooks, and some of the alignment was with attendance and losing credit in a class period or whatnot. So we've taken those, that wording out of there because it doesn't pertain to the middle school. And then a big change is on pages six and seven, an attendance matrix that we put in there. And working with Skeeter, and Skeeter working with the prosecutor's office, and parents understanding exactly what an excused absence and unexcused absence is, how many absences you guys as a board have approved to be okay until they start receiving our kindly worded letters about their attendance. So we wanted to outline that in our handbook, exactly what a verified and an unexcused and all the different attendances problems are there, and then some of the consequences or interventions that can come from not being in attendance at all times. And that has become an issue, but we've seen a lot of good progress with that, with working with Skeeter and Mr. Mars at the prosecutor's office. I think as we move down through, if you look at numbers 7 through 10, a lot of that is just removing 3 to 5 days as far as detentions go, because we really don't give 5 days of detention. If we get to where we're going to give that many, sometimes we move to a different consequence, like in-school suspension and so forth. So we just want to make sure we are clear and open and honest with the parents. That's why we made those changes. Number 11 has to do with our technology handbook. We want to make sure our discipline matrix match what we say in our technology handbook as far as when we get to a red cover and what happens prior to becoming a red cover student when you've misused technology or broken your iPad. Number 12 is just some of the clubs that no longer exist. We took out, we have young ladies that wrestle, so we changed wrestling to wrestling instead of boys wrestling to make sure that we were correct in that. And we no longer do our CSI program is what number 13, because we do all PBIS now, so we took CSI out. Number 14 is just the time change from 7:30 to 7:45. We don't allow the students in the hallways until 7:45, so there's no reason for the library to be open until at that time as well. So we've changed that. And then 24, or page 24 and 25 have to do with you guys approved stock EpiPens, and we got a few new AEDs, and so we wanted to make sure that was in there, where all that was located, and the fact that we do have the ability to administer EpiPen if needed, approved by you guys. Questions? Yeah, hopefully I can answer.
Hi. Feel a responsibility to read the handbooks, and so I really appreciate the copy we get that has the changes highlighted, because I don't want to reread the whole thing just to figure out the new stuff. So thanks for highlighting the changes.
That's all Mrs. Hayes, so
thank you.
She does that work.
Really important.
Yes, it is. And that currently, because she was worried about this, so I'll throw it out there. The page numbers do not match up right now, because when she goes in and starts to delete this stuff that we took out, that'll change, and we'll make sure that's in line before we have Kistler and the guys put it up on the website. So
that was going to be my question, Oscar. Was it okay? So this is going to go up on the website as we've done before. There, this wasn't as much an issue with the middle school one as there was with high school, but there is a formatting issue, and maybe that will be fixed when it's moved across, especially with the attendance matrix. And I know that that's something that's very important, and we just want to make sure that it's easy for them to see. This is on my iPad, so that might be part of it, but a lot of people will look at it through their website on the iPad.
Probably, yeah.
So that's just something
for
this non-technology literate.
Yeah, we can get Mrs. Good to see what that looks like, and then she can manipulate it on the website to make sure it comes through correctly.
Just a small
Okay, any other questions? Thank you, Oscar and Andy.
Thank you.
Adam, would you like to share?
Sure. Our changes revolve around things we've already had some conversations around the board meetings. One change is for the incoming freshman class, we are changing, the class of 2020, changing which classes are weighted and which classes are not. And that was approved by you guys previously this year, but that change will go into the handbook. Another change that we're adding is to our grading scale, which this will go into effect for everyone starting next year. We're adding an A+ to the grading scale, which is not currently there. So on the 4.0 grading scale, an A+, which would be a 100% or above, would be a 4.3. On the weighted scale, a 100% or above, A+, would be a 5.3. And then another change that we talked about is we're going to name our top 10 and our valedictorian and salutatorian after the 8th semester of high school instead of after the 7th. So that is a whole lot of changes because there's a lot of references to that in the handbook. That change will also occur starting next year. And the other change that we made was currently for a student to be top 10 eligible at the end of their senior year, there were a multitude of requirements that the student may have had to meet. So we're simplifying that the requirement is now just that they meet the standards of an Indiana academic honors diploma. Does anybody have any questions?
Thank you for looking at those, Adam, and your team, and refining those. I know Eli had a lot of other things he needed to do.
I wish he was here.
But he was one of the people who came and advocated for an A+ when that grading scale went into effect. And I would have loved for him to see this, so yes. We'll have to show it to him. But what was the thinking behind, for instance, for a B+ or a C+ or so on, it's 87 to 89%, for instance, for a B+. And so there's 3 percentage points that we're looking at that for the plus. Mm-hmm. What's the thinking behind having it only be the 100% mark for the A+?
We looked at what some other area schools were doing that had an A+. They all had 100% above. So, and we felt like for them to get this added boost to their GPA, it needs to be that they did an exceptional job in the classroom. So we felt like that was the most fair way to reward them.
We still do have the biggest, we still have 6 percentage points for the A, which doesn't, mathematically still isn't consistent across the grades. You know, if you do 2 percentages better, then you get moved up to the B+, that moves you 0.3 higher on the GPA. If you do that in an A, you don't get the 0.3 boost higher. And that's not what we have at the middle school, correct? I know GPA isn't an issue there, but we do have an A+ there. Is it 98 and above?
I think it's 98 point something. It's a 98 can be either an A or an A+, and I can't remember off the top. It was like 98.7, I want to think it is. I don't think it's 98.
It's somewhere around 98.
Yeah. And in middle school, it's less of an issue because you're not doing classroom
right.
GPA and so on.
Right.
To provide some of that consistency.
Okay. You have questions?
Did we have in there about stocking EpiPens in the high school one? I could have missed it.
It's in there.
It's in there? Okay, I missed it.
It's all red.
What have you done? That's in middle school. Is it? Because they have, there's a red.
Yeah, there is an addition. Well, this is for the Riddle.
Right, for Riddle, we need to make sure we can go back.
Thanks, Adam.
I'm sorry, Jim. I think it was in the high school, and it said just basically anyone trained. That's kind of.
I think we had EpiPen and lots of language in there last year.
No. Shouldn't have.
I'm pretty sure it's planned to be in there because Victoria's who gave us offers
right.
to put in.
Right, she's working on the consistency between the buildings and us, and that's why there's the addition to the Riddle handbook, which was not in there before. With that is coming the language from Victoria's, exactly, to follow the policy.
And this is obviously a very comprehensive document, so I definitely, I'm looking here, I see there's the information on the defibrillators and information on meningitis. and vaccines, and what is
stopped. If it was not in the copy you see now,
we'll make sure
it'll be what the middle school has is the same language we have. Okay.
And really, it's policy, and policy trumps. Not just policy trump the handbook, or it's just an addition to the handbook. Handbook is policy.
That's it. We'll go through and make sure those are consistent.
Thank you for your work on that.
Yes.
I'm a lot more comfortable with that than I have been. My daughter, who's graduating this spring, will be very upset with me that it's now getting changed.
Okay, thank you, Adam. This is the only addition to the Columbia Riddle
language. We went through elementary handbooks last meeting, and Jason went through that, and we wanted to make sure that we were consistent with the EpiPen language. So that would be the only noted change, is to make sure we have that across the district.
We have some formatting issues with this too.
Any other questions about handbooks? Not, we'll need a motion to approve.
I make a motion to approve the handbooks with the addition of the EpiPen language in the high school handbook.
Okay. Motion by Dwight. Second by Brad. Any other discussion? All in favor?
Go ahead, Morgan.
Okay. Go ahead. I'm just curious. I guess I do remember as a parent that it was different. I could care less which one it is. That doesn't really matter. But why are we different in grades 1 through 12? Like, why do we have different grading scales? I'm just kind of curious.
Interesting.
I remember it being that way when my boys did go through, but I just wondered when it happened and why we are.
No, go ahead, Brent.
No, I was just going to say, sorry, Tom. I should tell my place to acknowledge her. It's Tom's, and I apologize.
Oh, sorry.
We lost the A+ three calendar years ago at the high school.
Okay.
That's a good question.
I'm just curious, you know, like why are we different? Or maybe next year that might be something to consider, that we're the same district across. I don't know, it might be easier for parents, maybe. Mm-hmm. There wouldn't be an issue for Adam, like when they got to the high school. Like, you guys, like, open dorms now again. Sorry. I was just curious why it was
the difference if it's 98 at the middle school and 100 at the high school.
No, we can start looking into the history of that. It's a good question.
Yeah.
We should be able to answer it.
Good question, Lauren.
There is a correction on the calendar, too. The end of the first 9 weeks is listed as September 30th, which is what we had voted on our calendar. But then it's also listed October 5th, end of the first grading period. So that it's clear that we are really ending at September 30th.
Okay. We have a motion and second. Any more discussion? All in favor? Motion carries 6-0. Okay, moving on to approval of the district photographer contract.
What we're looking at right now is a contract with Interstate for the high school to roll that out. So I will begin working with the other buildings to see what would be best to meet their needs. I know there were concerns through the past couple of years in regards to our previous provider. So we would be looking at that Interstate contract to start out the summer with the high school, and then we'll bring you additional information at the next board meeting in regards to kindergarten through eighth grade and what direction we need to move there. Interstate can provide all of the needs for the yearbook to make sure that those are transferred over, our athletic program where we had some struggles before, those larger group activities, to make sure that we get those covered correctly. We're looking at different IDs and that type of thing, and Interstate can certainly provide for that, as well as giving a percentage back to the school based on the sales that they do.
Do we know if their price that they charge to the parents or the families is comparable to what they're being charged now?
His friend said that it would be comparable or less.
And they were able to offer a lot of different package upgrades at no additional charge.
Any other questions? Any motion to approve the contract for the photographer? Okay.
So is that an annual contract? Is that updated annual?
This would be annual.
Like an evergreen, or is it just a...
No, we would have to reevaluate it. Right. It would not be as we had previously, okay, with the evergreen.
Is the commission percentage the same?
That's a difficult question to answer.
But now we know what we'll be getting.
Exactly.
All right.
And the other schools in the area use Interstate?
Yes. Most, if not all.
Okay, good question.
If we accept this contract.
Okay, motion by Steve.
I'll second it.
And second by Lisa. Any other discussion? All in favor? Okay, motion carries 6-0. Approval of the parking lot asphalt bid.
We received three bids to redo the high school parking lot area this summer. This would not include the design structure that we would be painting. We are still working on that, and in fact just got blueprints back again that I've sent out to the team that is working on that. So this is, we're talking specifically for the asphalting of the school. We had three bids. Super Seal bid came in at $74,820. DC Construction came in at $41,152, and Ranger Materials came in at $45,168. The recommendation would be to go with DC Construction, and they have consistently had that bid in the past as well.
I have a question. Is the thickness of the sealant the same on each of these bids?
They were all sent out and quoted with the same specs from everybody.
Okay. Any other questions?
Have we used DC previously?
They've had the bid as long as we could check back and find. They've had our bid.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. I used this company for a commercial application, and they were great. Worked around our schedule. They were really very good.
And we're working that schedule in regards to the high school flooring that's going in, the roofing project and everything. We want to do it at a time where there isn't going to be a lot of heavy traffic moving back and forth. So this would be a late summer project right before we start in with school again after that heavy traffic from those larger vehicles has cleared the area.
Is this with the redesigned...
Yeah, that's just, we just have to submit the drawings for that, and we're continuing to fine-tune that. It's difficult when you're landlocked, and Skeeter and Oscar and Brad and everybody have diligently been working on that, and we send it off, and then they send us new ideas, and we just received some this afternoon that we're tossing around those ideas on.
Any other questions? Motion to approve DC Construction with a bid of $41,152 for the asphalt ceiling.
So,
Brad? Motion by Brad.
I'll second.
And second by Lisa. Any discussion? All in favor? Motion carries 6-0. Okay. Moving on to personnel report. Quite a few. Excuse me. Okay, retirement. We had a nice retirement reception tonight, and appreciate all the years of service these people have given us. Okay, retirement. Barb Van Dyne, Columbia first grade teacher. Glenda Burkett, Columbia instructional assistant primetime. Vicki Oro, Columbia special needs instructional assistant. Nora Hudkins, Riddle, Special Needs Instructional Assistant. Jerry Bretzinger, Riddle, Building Technician. And Bill Nicholson, Bus Driver. And we have resignations of Michael Zahner, High School PE Teacher and Head Football Coach. Jennifer Kimball, Columbia Building Technician. And Amy Olinger, Riddle Instructional Assistant. We have reassignment of Amy Olinger, Riddle Cafe Manager. Katie Felke withdrew as summer school health teacher. For summer school, we have Alan Sagers, High School Health. I read three summer remediation and retest, Mona Zion and Megan Schroeder. Duke Energy Grant Coordinator, Lauren Atkinson. Summer Intercession, Amy Freeman, Columbia. Amy Banks, Columbia. Megan Gongware, Columbia. Emily Brown, Instructional Assistant. Trevor Brown, High School. And Deb Wolford, High School Mathematics. And this time, take a, I entertain a motion to approve that part of the personnel report.
So moved.
Okay, motion by Steve.
I'll second.
And second by Jenny. All in favor? Okay, motion carried, 6-0.
If I may, Lauren is here. Lori's here this evening with the Duke Energy Grant Coordinator, and that is a grant that we received through Duke Energy, and I commend Jason for allowing us that opportunity to open that up for somebody who was working on their administrative license to really experience the process from conception of following the grant to posting the position to hiring those personnel that they're going to need and working with all of those departments. And Lori is working on her administrative degree, and she has done a wonderful job of launching that, including a late night text that said, how do you tell people, or how do you work through this interview process? And so really good questions, and starting to experience that and have that real life relevant experience. So congratulations to you, Lori, and I know you'll have a great support there with Jason, but commending you on the work that you're doing, and you'll learn a lot this summer, I'm sure. Already have. Those late night tasks are, excuse me, coming in.
Okay, then we have Charlie Schwank receive a stipend for the Riddle Running Club.
If I could, I wanted to just share that I have received several emails. It was actually, it started with Angie Smith from Riddle, just really commending Charlie and the work that she has done in regards to the running club. I've had several individuals reach out and share how that has built a solid cross-country team there at the middle school, how it continues to perpetuate itself into the track. As we look through, that had not been approved when we sent out that ECA list. And at Riddle, within that ECA list, it does have extra clubs and organizations built in so that we could budget for, but they haven't been utilized. And this is something that was brought to me by Riddle staff, wanting to acknowledge her and her hard work in regards to this. And I want to make that recommendation that we pay her that ECA stipend. I would like for it to go back retroactive. She had the running club in the fall as well, and she would not have received that first portion of the payment. It's a minimal payment. I think it's like $123 times two, or $127 times two. So it's a minimal payment for a lot of effort and energy that she puts into those youth, and that relates into programming later on for our athletics.
I commend Charlie and the many, many hours that she has volunteered to do that. In that same breath, though, I know that we've had changes in our administration at both elementary schools, and I would encourage a reopening of the ECA for our new principals to look at that, because I think that there was at least one position that was way overlooked at Columbia as well. So that would could be an ongoing conversation.
Okay. I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Okay, motion by Brad.
And I would gladly second that.
Okay, second by Lisa. And I will be abstaining since Charlie's my wife. All in favor? Okay, motion carries, 5-1 abstention. Okay, thank you. And now we're going to move on to some hirings. We're going to start with Greg Mertz, athletic director.
Adam, would you like to introduce Greg and share?
Sure. Greg is here this evening with us. Greg is, for the last year, has been the athletic director at Wabash High School. Prior to that, he was the athletic director at Frontier for
9 years.
So he comes to us with a lot of experience. He's very organized. He brings a lot of knowledge to our athletic department. I think he's going to be able to do a lot of things to help us move forward and take some next steps as a department.
I know that he's been in, he started to meet with coaches He's bleeding that black and white already. He was in the office and he had on a zebra wear, so we wanted to make sure, and he verified that he came in with that black and white on, so he's ready to go.
Okay, Greg, we're going to vote first, and we're going to want to hear from you a little bit, so don't go away. I'll entertain the motion to approve Greg Mertz, athletic director.
So moved.
Okay, motion by Brad and second by Don. Any discussion? On paper? Motion 6-0.
Greg, would you introduce, if you brought anybody with you, and tell us a little bit about yourself?
I've got my wife, Josette. Stand up, show them. Our daughter, Jada, who is a first grader. Wave to everybody.
Oh, and she's got yellow and gold.
I'm really excited to be here. Rochester's got a pretty good tradition and a foundation in athletics. It's been around for a long time, and I'm happy to be a part of it. And next year will be my 12th year as athletic director and 22 total years in education. So great school, and I'm looking forward to it.
Okay. Thanks, Greg. Welcome. Okay, next we have Luke Biernacki, Riddle School Principal.
Luke went through probably the most rigorous portion of our interview process. Oscar's grinning because he said he was glad it was Luke and not himself. But Luke went through two separate interviews and was just an outstanding candidate and continued to rise above the rest of the pool. And so just want to recommend Luke for the Riddle position. He brings experience to us and will be a great asset to our administrative team. Has a love and passion for Rochester schools and for the youth of our community.
I'm gonna ask the same of you too, Luke, so hang on. This time we'll take a motion to approve Luke Biernacki, Riddle School Principal.
So moved.
Okay, motion by Jenny.
I'll second.
Second by Lisa. All in favor? Okay, motion carries 6-0. Talk to us, Luke.
I have Kate and Maida here, my son and daughter. We've lived here, they've lived here their whole lives. I moved here in 2009 and been really working hard to become a part of this corporation. I love Rochester, love living here, and truly want to have an impact on our school corporation as well as our community as a whole. So I look forward to the new challenges. Everyone I've met, from our administrators to the staff, has just been so welcoming and exciting that I'm just proud to be here in this position, and I thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you. I must say how well all three of the kids have been.
Yes.
I couldn't sit still. You're great. Okay, thank you. Next, we have Joe Grant, high school PE teacher and head varsity football coach.
And I will allow our new AD to walk us through that process of hiring and how that came about.
Sure. Well, when I was hired, I was told I needed to take the lead on hiring a football coach, which I was glad to do. And I can speak, I think, for the whole committee that Joe rises above everybody else. He comes from a good story program at Sheridan. He also was part of the IU program, and he's from North Miami, so he's got close roots to Rochester as well as the TRC conference. And I'm excited for him because I think he's going to do very well, and he's a good young coach, and I look forward to him growing professionally.
And if I may add, one of the first phone calls I got about the interview process was Adam, who very clearly stated he was our best candidate for the teaching for the classroom. And Jana, when we interviewed him, he came across as the best for the football position as well. And so that is always a win-win situation. So I wanted to acknowledge the academic portion of that as well, and making sure that that was exactly what Adam stressed to me in that order. So it's exciting to know that we have a good fit in both areas.
I guess I need to stand up.
Well, I think we need to wait on approval for. Oh.
Okay. Okay, at this time, we'll take a motion to approve Joe Grant, high school PE teacher and head varsity football coach.
So moved.
Okay, motion by Brad.
I second that.
And second by Steve. All in favor? Motion carries 6-0.
Now the floor is all yours.
Now, I guess I'll have my wife stand up. This is Brittany.
Hi.
So, when this whole process started, in my interview, I left and I called my wife right away and I said, I want to be a Zebra. And as a North Miami guy, calling my dad is a North Miami guy, he kind of double checked and said, you know, what are you talking about? I didn't tell anybody I really had an interview. As a young coach, being with Sheridan, being with Coach Wright, who's in his 52nd year as a football coach, he gave me advice, you know, wait a few years. I was with IU football for 5 years, and then I was 3 years with Coach Wright, and he gave me some advice right away and said, you know, wait a few years, you know, find the right place. Don't just jump into something. And I knew when I left here, it was the right place, and I told my wife, you know, if I'm fortunate enough to get this phone call and go through this process longer, then I know this is the place I want to be. So I knew right then and there, you know, yeah, I was a North Miami guy, and I was proud to be a Blackhawk. But right then and there, and then when Mr. Marks called me, I couldn't be happy to be a Zebra, and look forward to being here for a long time. Thank you.
Okay. Hooray for superintendent business.
Sure. When you arrived this evening, you should have found a packet in front of you from Terry Lee in regards to safe sidewalks and reporting about safe sidewalks to school. He asked that you would look through that information, formulate any questions, those types of things that you may have in regards to a conversation, and then he will be at our next meeting to walk you through that, to answer any questions, and to continue forward with that community-wide project. In regards to the roofing update, we are meeting again with Morris and Sons on Wednesday. They've done a wonderful job keeping up and communicating and making sure that they are on track. I'm anxious to hear with all of the weather and rain and everything that we've had, where they are scheduling-wise, but I know that they, since the weather has cleared, they have been on the roof at the break of day and are continuing to work on that. So I will have an update to you on Wednesday in regards to that. I'd like to take just a moment to recognize Lisa Lee. Lisa received a CAP award from the ISBA for her spring attendance in regional meetings, and so the Indiana School Boards Association, and I would like to recognize you in regards to that, Lisa. So thank you for representing our board and our district. And then finally, June 6th, we will have our next study session, and that will be an evening study session. Again, we're trying to get those on a quarterly basis, so it gives the public an opportunity to attend an evening session when they may not otherwise be able to attend those morning sessions that we have. So June 6th at 6 o'clock. A gentle reminder to the board that we're serving breakfast. Actually, you're serving breakfast Wednesday morning, so make sure you're there, ready. We've got the food ordered and prepared, and we've invited the faculty and staff to celebrate the end of a successful academic year. And I think that's all I have.
Okay. Does the board have any other concerns, questions, or statements? Anyone in the audience?
This is our new administrator who didn't realize the Thursday noon. She just bought Thursday. So we got those late in the afternoon.
To be fair, she didn't just hand them in right now.
No.
We didn't
have them. Yeah, I mentioned Thursday. I neglected to mention the noon cutoff time, so that was mine. I'll take the rap on that one. Thanks.
So this is hot off the press. These teachers would be involved with the Duke Energy Grants and would not impact our general fund. And these are the teachers recommended: Amy Banks, Kylie Day, Sarah Dalton, Amy Freeman, Megan Gongwer, and Bethany Sewell. Do we need a motion on that?
Yes. I move we accept the recommendations from Mrs. Atkinson.
Okay.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor? Okay, motion carried, 6-0.
You've got your child.
Got it in.
There you go. I'd like to take a minute to thank everybody for these new adventures that they're going on this summer and this fall. I think it's going to be really exciting. A lot of good things going on.
Okay. Anybody else? Okay, if not, thanks everybody for coming, and we'll adjourn the meeting.
Okay, this one.
It's under 30 minutes, so I will do my best. We've got three ladies that are retiring. They have served our corporation for many years, and it's going to be very, very tough to replace. I don't think you can actually ever replace somebody like these ladies. But tonight we have Melinda Burkett, and we've got Barb Van Dyne, and Vicki Horoho, who could not be here tonight. She had another appointment. I'm going to talk a little bit about these ladies here for just a minute. I'm going to start with Mrs. Burkett, and I tried to get stories, because everybody wants to hear stories and stuff. And I think that we're fortunate that one of the things that, if you really want to get a good story from somebody, you can ask the kids. So for Mrs. Burkett, I have a whole stack of stories going to get me through my 30 minutes here. I'm actually going to read you the top three of them, just the first three, and I'm going to let you enjoy the rest of them. But I think hearing from a student, a little bit about that is pretty important. But Mrs. Burkett was born in Rochester. She graduated from RHS in 1971. She attended Ball State and has been married to Bill here for 42 years. They have three daughters, six grandchildren, and she began working at Columbia in 1988. She's worked in kindergarten, first grade, second grade, and third grade, and she's also worked for the after-school program and summer school. And obviously, I think the one thing that really stands out in my mind for both of these ladies and for Mrs. Horo is just the love that they have for the kids. And that's what it's all about, and that's how you can be in education for so long. Quick story here from Mrs. Keller, who she works with. The first time I had an opportunity to work with Melinda was when this year's seventh graders were in kindergarten. It was without a doubt the toughest group of kids that I ever had. But I remember the first day of school, I had five kids crying, one throwing themselves to the ground, and another one hiding under the tables. She walked in, and the first thing that came out of her mouth was, "Oh my." Mrs. Keller's words. I must admit, I might have used different words coming out of my mouth. But she was my savior that year. She did everything that was asked of her, and she took the lead when I needed a moment to gather my thoughts. I would have not made it through the first 9 weeks without her. For the last 3 years, she's been an IA in my classroom, the first year as special needs IA, and the last year as a kindergarten IA. Words cannot express the gratitude that I have for her. She has always worked so well with the kids, and they truly adore her. Melinda is so good at what she does. I can give her plans and activities, and she takes them and makes them her own. She knows what the kids need, whether it involves academics, a hug, or just someone to listen to them. Columbia and Rochester Community Schools are losing a great asset this year, and she will be greatly missed, but Mrs. Keller is very grateful for everything that she's done. And let's hear from a couple of the kids. Mrs. Burkett fixes the dolls' heads. And she helps us when we get hurt. She is my favorite teacher. Here's one of them for you. Mrs. Burkett is nice. She is wonderful. I like Mrs. Burkett, and she's so very helpful. We're so lucky to have Mrs. Burkett. I'm not sure if that's you or me, but it is very good drawing. There might be a tie on there, so that's why I'm saying that. And this one here, I love Mrs. Burkett because she helps us. She helps us with our morning work and opening our home.
and I love you. So I'm going to give you all of these. Mrs. Burkett, we greatly appreciate everything that you've done, and thank you for your service to Rochester. Barb Van Dyne has, she's been, I'm just going to start off right now with just a little bit of a personal story that I had. As I was teaching the STEM classes last year, the beginning of this year, Barb has always been one to just check in on me. Make sure, you know, that her kids were well behaved in class, and just to make sure that I had the things that I needed. And even as we kind of had that transition in the middle of the year, she continued to do that, always stopping in, always checking on me, and it really made me feel good because it was almost like a mother figure where, you know, I had somebody checking in on me, and I just can't express how grateful I was just to have somebody do that. And she brought me in, she may not want me to tell you this, but she brought me in some chocolate covered peanuts, just a little gift for really no reason, just to kind of say thank you. And so we had those, and I had them in my office for a couple of days, and my daughter found them and started eating them. The next thing you know, I found the box at home, and I was trying to figure out, you know, how that happened, and we'll come to find out. Ripley,
Mommy,
started getting those. She took them home, decided to share them with everybody, so I didn't really get to enjoy them. But my family, thanks you very much. So, but Barb she was a graduate from Bremen, and she got a degree from Purdue University, and she worked at Argus Elementary as an IA and did a maternity leave there. She met her husband, Richard, and they married the following summer. That fall, she was employed by Tippy Valley as a Title I reading director, and she taught third grade at Mentone for 2 years. She received her master's degree from Indiana University South Bend and also a lifetime teaching license. Their daughter Amy was born. Their son Tony was born 2 years later. She worked for a company out of her home for 16 years, was able to earn sales incentives. So these are all the places that she's been. She loves to travel. Hawaii, Israel, Greece, the Greek islands, Italy, Spain, Austria, Germany, England, Alaska, Amsterdam, and Turkey. So if you have any vacations coming up, any ideas, she'll be available to help plan those. She taught at Grace Methodist Nursery for 2 years when her children were in nursery school. She substitute taught at Argus, Tippy Valley, and Rochester with the hopes of getting back into education. There were no job offers, but she still had that passion to get back into teaching. She worked at a John Deere.
Why did I have to?
I'm telling you how many years you've done this. That's why. She worked at a John Deere dealership in Warsaw, and in 96, she was hired as an IA kindergarten, moved to a computer lab, and fulfilled a first grade maternity leave. The next year, she did morning IA with Kathy Sutton and taught math in her room in the afternoon. She had her own first grade classroom. At that time, it was split between her and Miss Amy's class. They actually had a wall in that at that time. And all she had room for was a teacher's desk and the student's desk. The following year, she moved across the hall and has been there ever since. So for her 24 years of public teaching, 20 of those years have been at Rochester and at Columbia. She looks forward to spending time with family, obviously traveling, going places, and coming back and making sure that I'm okay.
That's right.
So, I greatly appreciate it, and thank you, Mrs. Van Dyne, for your service. Too, but I was told that those are for tomorrow.
So.
And Vicki Burrow, she wrote me a little thing. She couldn't be here tonight, but she grew up just east of here in North Manchester. And in 83, they settled in Rochester where they felt like it was home. It's been a great place to raise their three children. In 1989, she was happy to be hired as an IA at Columbia. It was a perfect job for a mom with young school kids. My first year, my day was split between Mrs. Meixel's second grade class and Penny Tyrone's third grade class. Since that first year, she's had a variety of positions all at Columbia. She spent several years as a helper in one classroom and also traveled from one class to a class helping out those that, or as they were needed. 1 year, she managed the second grade mobile computer lab, pushing laptops room to room. And for several years, four IAs rode around from the high school to Columbia in the mornings, and she did that. In her 27 years, she's worked with three superintendents, six principals, and she didn't mention how many teachers, but she described them as fine teachers and IAs who she has the fortunate, and she's been fortunate enough to be able to call as friends. Even though she knows it's time to go, she sincerely can say that she will miss working with the teachers and the support staff, and she wanted to tell everybody here thank you for those memories. And Mrs. Van Dyne has had the pleasure to work with her as well, and she just shares that she's an amazing artist, uses that talent with the kids, and she will be especially missed in the teacher's lounge, where she was very knowledgeable in Rochester, and not in a bad way, but a go-to person. If you need to know somebody in Rochester and what they did, or you know how they could help you if you needed a fence put up or whatever, she knew those people. So thank you all for coming tonight and for recognizing these ladies and their service to not only Columbia, but also to the Rochester community.
We have three retirees at Will. First of all, Nora Hudkins, teaching assistant, special needs assistant. She couldn't be here tonight, but she had 12 years working with Rochester Schools, and she will be dearly missed by all the staff. We do have Jerry Brittenmer here tonight. Jerry has 20 years of service with custodial maintenance service here with Rochester Schools. And Roger Muse, our head custodian, was going to be here, but he had an appointment and he couldn't be here. But I was just talking to Jerry before we started. He even worked 23 years before coming here with Roger. So they had 43 years of working together. But I have to say, Jerry is the most punctual person I have ever met in the building. I can set my watch by him. And after school bus duty in the afternoon, I can walk in, and the bathroom in his area is already clean, mopped, sanitized, and trash taken out. And he's very diligent with his work. He does a great job. And we wish Jerry all the best. He's got some hobbies at home. He was mentioning gardening. And so we wanted to mention Jerry tonight. So congratulations, Jerry. Is Paul Helstern. Paul has 40 years of teaching.
Mr. Emmert, yes. I have to interrupt on this. He's, Paul, yes. I finally caught up with you. Mr. Peeps. So you are currently under arrest. You're going to have to miss the rest of this party. I'm sorry.
Can I interrupt you, Mr. Emmert, just to explain that? And I apologize for jumping in. Probably one of the first years I was teaching, Peggy Wurlich was known for her sense of humor. And she came across an article in a newspaper about a criminal named Teak. And it could have been Paul's twin brother. And for the next, I don't know how many years, that picture would surface in our teacher's lounge, and we had Paul Teak. And it's just been kind of a, for the old ones that have been around for about long, it's been it's followed him all these years. So I saw that Skeeter was available to take care of him tonight.
I don't have my keys, Paul. Tell you what, I have my keys.
We do have some special things planned for all three of our retirees this week, but I had asked a couple people to maybe speak on Paul's behalf. So I'm going to ask Judy first. Go ahead, Judy Coffey.
I have just a minute. It's just in big print. So I can see it. I was kind of taken back when Mr. Emmert asked me to do this, because I thought
what on earth can I tell people about Paul that,
be careful.
That people can hear?
Be careful.
What
we go
on earth
trips
can
together.
I tell people about Paul? Yeah. But I decided after about 15 minutes that just the sheer joy of making him turn red would be worth it. But he turned. Oh,
they will miss that.
And now we can go on. I met Paul, the educator, 23 years ago in August, and I can't believe it's been that long, but it has. And I had to write some of this. So Paul graduated from Milton Union High School in West Milton, Ohio, in 1972. He attended and graduated from North Manchester College in 1976, and he received his master's from IU in 1979. And if any of this is wrong, it's Nancy's fault. It was literally years before I realized that Paul attended college in Indiana, because all I saw was Ohio State shirts, red all over the classroom, trinkets, colors, flags, you name it.
That's why
he turns red. And like Mr. Emmer said, he's now taught 40 years, and what I found was amazing was all 40 years were in this county. And I thought that was great. My introduction to Paul was made by the individual that hired me to work in this corporation. And I know some of the older ones will remember Helen Ho. Some of the younger ones probably had her as your nurse. But she had a very no-nonsense manner. So, in her no-nonsense manner, she simply said, "This is Paul Helstern, and he will never show up on time for any screening you schedule."
It's true.
And she was so right. His little broods would always march down the hall, single file, right behind him. And they either had a book or a tablet and pencil in their hand. Of course, times change now. I realize it's iPads, but that's the way it goes. But I would always laugh when they go by my door, because Paul's stride is 3 feet long, and all of these little ones are trying to keep up, doing their best to keep up. But their little legs look like they were going in circles, and their arms were really swinging just to keep up with him. Gotta get the momentum going. I always thought his room was really homey and inviting. I never remember having a classroom that had cushions and curtains and places to go in a corner so that you could go read. The only thing I remember was getting swatted on my behind with the Dick and Jane teacher's version reader for talking to my neighbor. My nurse's freezer was always full of popsicles. Always had popsicles in there for him. But the one thing that he did not like was puke. Couldn't do it. He could clear out a classroom faster than you can imagine. It was best just to send him home immediately. So, some days the man drove me absolutely crazy. 10 years ago, next month, I met Paul Helstrom. My husband and I began traveling with Paul and Nancy, and our first trip was to Alaska. I loved it. But this is when I learned about the caring, always wanting to learn, ADHD male adult. You have not lived until you have gone through airport security behind Paul Helstrom. You have no idea how long it takes him to empty his pockets, get the backpack, and you pray that he wore slip-ons that day. Nancy and I swear we're getting him a man bag. He's the only guy I know that can schedule a walking tour of New York City for 7:30 in the morning, followed by a ferry tour over to the Statue of Liberty, and then back downtown to the NBC store, Lego store, Rockefeller Plaza, and don't forget Hershey's. 10 o'clock at night, Nancy and I are crashing. Paul heads for Times Square and goes tie shopping. We refer to this as a fall vacation. But what never ceases to amaze me is always learning. Whether it is about tundra vegetation or humpback whale feeding frenzies, whether it's about what the base of the Statue of Liberty is made of, or what battle was fought at the fort in Nassau. Ever been to a cooking class in Mexico? Yeah. Even on the ship, while the three of us are sitting by the pool reading, Paul's in ceramic class. And always because he wanted to bring back something new and different to do with next year's class. Paul, enjoy the retirement thing. It takes a little getting used to, but it's awesome. Enjoy the soon-to-be four grandkids. Preschool drop-off is a hoot. And I truly look forward to our October fall foliage tour of the East Coast.
Me too. Thank you.
Jill Weaver would like to say something about Paul.
But you know, Paul, I could have gone two roads to do this.
That's true.
One red-faced, maybe one not so red-faced.
And you chose.
Well, we'll see. I also was told by somebody did before I started this to ask, are you truly retiring? Is this official?
Yes.
Okay, because we've heard this for a couple of years now. Yeah, I'm going to retire next year. I'm going to retire next year, so I can go ahead. I guess in knowing Paul, and Paul and I really go way back, and this is like almost family way back, except for it's my husband's family. His cousin is married to my brother-in-law, and because of that connection, he's got connected with the Weaver family and was even my husband's roommate in college. And so I knew Paul, I did my student teaching with Paul's sister then. So, I mean, there's just a real background there. I knew Paul before I even moved to Rochester. And so one of the things in watching him and teaching with him, he loves teaching math. And so I wanted to do a little bit of math for Paul today and really take a look at what 40 years of teaching looks like. So, I did use my calculator, I'll tell you. But I figured out that 40 years, and I did take a few times out because, like, you've had a surgery here and some things have happened. So, but you've taught over 7,000 days. And you have influenced over 1,100 students. Which means you've also had over 1,100 conferences with parents. That probably, if I'm thinking right, I almost could double that number. Because when you do case conferences and everything else, it really can get a lot. Over 50,400 plus daily lesson plans. 7 to 8 different reading language arts series. 7 to 8 different math series, 7 to 8 different science, social studies series. Oh, there's a lot there. I'm sure that you were well over 100 field trips and then other outings, planned or supervised. So now away from the math to some of the stories. I don't know if you knew this, Paul, but you were crowned at one point the copy king.
Yes.
but you would walk in his room and you would never know it because he was also the most organized person I've ever been around. And if you needed something, hang on just a second. You go over, open the right drawer, pull it out. There it was. I marveled at that. You also, I'm sure, have the best cursive handwriting for a lefty. And you also hold the record for the most paid for an apple pie at an auction. Paul is creative, and when I first started teaching with Paul, really was some of my first years of teaching here at Rochester. That was back in the time when paddling was not frowned upon at all. In fact, Paul had his very own paddle in his classroom, and there was one day that Stephanie Barkman went to his room speaking up, said, Mr. Halster, but we were having some problems with the kids. And Paul said, I know how to handle this. And so she went in and said, Mr. Halster, I need you and your paddle. And then he comes to my room, paddle in hand, and said, Mrs. Weaver, I need you in the hallway. Stephanie had gone back to her room. He goes to her room and said, Mrs. Barfin, I need you in the hallway. And he had his paddle. So he goes out there and then takes his shoe and hits it, the bottom of it, so hard, made me scream. And I'm sure those kids are just like, what is going on? It took him a little while to figure this out, but it worked. And just despite having that paddle, never saw him show anything but love and kindness to his students. Never saw him swing it besides on his own foot. This is the hard ones for me. Friendship. Such friendship and kindness to our staff. When my four-year-old daughter had a depressed skull fracture, it was Paul and Stephanie were the first ones to come to our house when we were able to bring her home from the hospital. They were nice. And one in particular, I had a bad migraine, didn't feel like it was safe for me to drive home. Paul sat at my desk and waited for it to pass. Paul, you fought the good fight. You worked hard, and you found one grace. Thank you for all you've done for me and my family. Thank you for all you've done for your students. Thank you for all you've done for Rochester Community Schools. We will miss you.
Like I said, we have some stuff planned for this week, a little too, but congratulations to Jerry. And congratulations to Paul. Thank you.
I know. Except to say thank you so very much to all of you for your service. I have had a very distinct honor to get to interact with all of our retirees. Always to get a great hug from Mrs. Van Dyne in the hallway. She has the best ones. Melinda and I go way back. Her oldest daughter and myself were best friends all through high school. And the studying factor that Mrs. Burkett is in the building, she does it. She's just so steady. And any of you who have worked with small ones think, wow. And I couldn't have said it better than Mr. Snyder did about Mrs. Horahoe. And if you want to know what's going on, Mrs. Horahoe is synonymous. To me, she is synonymous with Columbia. She is just such a bright spot, and we will miss her. I got to work in the building when Jerry was there, and he has taken such great care of that building. And Mr. Halster and I got to have as a teacher, because we rotated, you know, so he's one of my teachers. And we used to, back then, have some really fun summer schools that we would do. And I am not an artist. That's why I taught kindergarten, because kindergartners think you're great. But that is such a talent of Paul's. And I still, well, until very recently had one of the projects that we did, where we put nails into a board and put string around it, and I just love the creativity he always brought to his class.
He still uses it.
Hey, but it's a good idea. You should. So thank you all very much.
I just want to say that you're part of why I can tell people that we have a great school system, so thank you. And the teachers that I remember most are the ones that cared, not necessarily the ones that knew the most. So people don't care what you know until they know you care. So thank you so much for that. And I do want to tell something on Nora, the IA.
Yes, please do.
She's a card. I wish she could have been here. But she told me one day that she stopped an argument between two boys. They were kind of fighting. And she's kind of creative, and she just turned around and said, do these pants make my butt look big? The fight was over.
Retirees, do you have anything you would like to share? They've never been so fun. Anybody? anybody else that would like to share before we just fellowship and enjoy the refreshments?
I really have a hard time being quiet. I talked with Paul for quite a few years, and anyone who really knew us probably thought we were having an affair because we talked all the time. And Paul and I discussed everything. We talked after school. We discussed how we were going to handle problems and how we were going to deal with kids' problems. And I really didn't like Paul at first. In fact, I was just actually ticked off at Paul. I had had Lenny Wilson as my student teacher the year before. And I knew they were going to hire another third grade teacher next door. They were converting part of the library into a classroom, and they were going to put another third grade teacher next door. And I knew who it needed to be. It was going to be my student teacher, Winnie Wilson. And she didn't get the job. They hired some dude from Caston, by the name of Paul Helster. And I didn't like it. He seemed nice enough, but I knew Winnie would do a better job. But I grew to like him. And Winnie did get a job, as you guys all know. She is wonderful. But you know what? I discovered Paul Helston was pretty wonderful, too. And he may be a better teacher. And hopefully I helped him a few times. We did smack the shoe in the hallway. All the classrooms got really quiet. He thought, my classroom thought it was from his room, and his classroom thought it was from my room, and everybody thought somebody got smacked. No one got spanking. Everybody wondered who got in trouble. And I'll tell you, they were all late. They were all working very hard, and they went into the classrooms, and all the just act like things were, people were in trouble, and they really weren't in trouble at all. We just kind of deceived them a little bit. Paul, we went on lots of field trips and had lots of fun, but we sweated out a few times too.
Yep.
We went, at that time in third grade, we went to the Shrine Circus on Saturdays. And early in the morning. And we lost kids. We had all sorts of people. And we got paid so well for that, too.
Yes, we did.
Yes, we did. But we had lots of good memories from that. And that's what kids remember. It's just like you said. They remember the stories. They remember the things that happened and the things that you told them and the connections that you made with the kids. It's not what you taught us. I can't remember a thing my teachers ever taught me. I really can't. Somewhere along the line, I learned something. But I remember the connections they made with me. Is that what you remember with your teachers? The connections they made. They were either bad, but they were good. And some of them I remember were bad, too. Paul made a lot of good connections. And I'm so proud to have talked with him. You told a funny story, and I've got to tell a funny story too. And it's not even on Paul. It's not even on you.
No.
But it is about pants being unzipped. Oh. So it's not your pants, it's mine. Oh. One day I was getting a spelling test, and I'm walking around, and this little girl is writing a note. And as I walk by her, she's writing a note, and we're taking a test. And I just pick up the note and go on. And as I get clear over on the other side of the classroom, and I face her, I open up the note, and it says, "Your pants are unzipped." And I turn around. Gotta love the kids. I had 39 years, didn't quite make it 40, but I loved teaching too, and I enjoyed the years with Paul and with Joe and many others. Congratulations.
A sincere thank you to each and every one of you. You represent what we strive so desperately for, and so just a sincere thank you. And at this time, if you'd like, we can fellowship. There's cake and punch here and continue to enjoy each other's company. And at 6:30, we'll start our board meeting, and we'll invite you to stay for that as well. There's always excitement that happens there, too. So
don't want to miss it.